Welcome back, everyone. Thank you so much for attending another session of SQL Server 2014. My name is Darmadi Komo, and I'm your host today. With me, I have AJ from engineering. AJ, would you want to tell us who you are, where you come from, and then what are you going to talk about today?
Hi, everyone. Welcome to today's session on another topic on mission critical performance. My name is AJ Jagannathan. I'm a senior program manager in the SQL Server product team, and I'm responsible for releasing all the cumulative updates and hot fixes that you see for all your SQL servers. In addition to that, I also work with the storage engine and SQL Server operating system features in SQL Server. And overall, I've been working with SQL Server for more than 15 years. I've been involved with this product from very beginning versions like SQL Server 6.5, and this will be my 8th release of the product that I've been involved directly or indirectly, and really enjoy talking to customers internally or externally who use our product and leverage all the great features.
Awesome.
Yep. So today, we're going to talk about two key improvements in SQL Server in this theme of online database operations. The first one is called Managed Lock Priority, and the second one is called Single Partition Online Index Rebuild. So here's the course outline for what we're going to cover today. For both the topics, we'll be looking at what the current problem space is, what are the benefits with the new improvements, and some of the diagnostics that are being introduced to help you troubleshoot problems in these areas. And finally, we'll look at some best practice recommendations on how you can leverage these features in your database environments.
Okay, awesome. Can you tell us more about the managed lock priority? How does it work?
Sure. So let's go and look at the very first improvement, and it's called managed lock priority. You may also hear me use the keyword MLP for short. And before we dive into what the feature itself is, I'd like to go over what the current problem statement is, what the current behavior that users experience, and what we are trying to solve with this new feature. We'll also look at some of the benefits and what permissions are required to use this feature. Finally, we will dive into some diagnostics that have been enabled and look at how this feature works. So what is the problem statement? Today, in most mission-critical environments, two of the most common database maintenance operations involve partition switching and index rebuilds. And as most of you as DBAs are very familiar with these space, you may encounter downtime because both these operations involve taking locks at the database level, which can prevent your user workload from running, which can basically cause some timeouts or blocking on your user workload. It leads to workload slowdown and timeouts. It has a big impact on mission-critical tier one environments. The main reason is during both partition switching and online index rebuilds, SQL Server requires to take some locks for a short term to make some changes in the internal system tables. We call this schema modification locks because we are changing some of the internal metadata that SQL Server maintains about partitions or indexes. So these locks conflict with regular locks that user queries require. For example, if you are in a transactional environment and where you're running report queries, which typically require shared locks, these locks will conflict with schema modification locks. So this will result in blocking. Thereby, either the users are blocked if the schema modification query is issued first, or the schema modification query is blocked if the user query is executed first. So either way, the experience is bad, either for the DBA or the database administrator, or the users using the database applications. So to show a quick animation on how this works, let's take a look of how the behavior is today in SQL Server 2012 and older versions. On the left side on this slide deck, under the session square, you can see various sessions that have been waiting to run on the system. On the right side, I have a lock queue. This is a very high-level description of how things work in the lock manager. For the interest of this animation, let's keep it simple. Let's say session 51 is going to run a select statement, and it requires a shared lock on the system. Since there are no users who are holding any conflicting locks, the lock is granted, and the session 51 is able to run. let's say your second query that needs to run is the alter partition or the online index rebuild. This is the DDL on session 52. Since it requires a schema modification lock, and since that lock conflicts with the currently running select statement, it's blocked and put in the wait queue by SQL Server. Now, let's say session 53 needs to run next. Though this session does not conflict with 51, it is queued behind 52 because of the way SQL Server implements the queuing of lock requests. And thereby, any further queries, even though they don't conflict with session 51, namely 54 and 55, are also blocked behind 52 because 52 cannot run till 51 finishes. So once 51 finishes, 52 is able to run, and since there is no conflicting locks, and once 52 is running, 53, 54, and 55 cannot run because all of them hold conflicting locks, so they have to wait. Once 52 finishes, all the other three can run in parallel because they don't need to have any conflicting resources, so they're able to run immediately. And so basically, to summarize this slide, the experience is the user has to be in a first-in, first-out queue. Unfortunately, if it's a completely read-only workload, in an ideal world, if there is no DDL in between, you would have been able to run 51, 53, 54, and 55 all in parallel, so there is no workload issues. Since we had to run an indexing statement in between, that basically interjects in between your other queries and can cause your throughput to come down. So this explains the current problem that we have in today's systems. So now let's dive into what the new feature provides us. So in Manage Lock Priority options, we provide three additional choices for the DBA when executing the DDL statement. The first option is called Kill All Blockers. So when you execute the DDL, you have an option to specify whether you want to abort any of your blocking queries, and if you need to wait for a certain time before you need to abort. So this is specified by the max duration parameter. We'll get into the exact syntax when I do the demo. So the next option is switch to normal queue. Let's say you're issuing the DDL and you don't want to kill any blocking queries because you feel that they are important and your DDL has a lower priority and they can wait. So in this case, you can specify your max duration and tell the query that if you don't get the lock within the specified time, return to the normal locking queue and wait till you can get a lock. And the final option is called exit DDL after wait. You can also think of it like the suicide mode, where you specify that at the end of your max duration, you kill the DDL itself. So your blocking transactions continue, and any of the DDL is exited, and you will have to retry this after some time. So the key point to remember is, in all these three switches, SQL Server puts the DDL in what is called a low priority lock queue. So any of your concurrent workloads, if you go back to your previous animation that you saw, the 52 was the DDL queue. It will be in the lower priority queue. 51, 53, and 54 will all be in the normal queue, and they will all run in parallel. And 52 will try to find a window where it can run. And as long as it gets an opportunity run, it will run quickly. If not, it will wait and take an action based on what max duration you have specified. And another important point to remember at the bottom of this slide is, during this max duration, if your lock queue becomes empty, so that if there is no other blocking query, the query is executed immediately, you don't have to wait till the entire duration of the max duration to execute the DDL. So these are the various options that we provide with SQL Server 2014 for executing this database maintenance operations. Let's look at some more details on the locking behavior. So when partition switch is executed using the alter table partition command, you basically switch source partition with the destination partition. So in this case, if you specify abort blockers, then it'll have to kill any blocking queries which are holding locks at both source and destination tables. And because the schema modification locks are acquired at both sides. And in case of online index rebuild, when you specify the max duration, This applies to every lock, so the max duration counter will be reset for every lock that is acquired, because there are a lot of locks acquired during various stages of an index rebuild. So for every lock that is acquired, the max duration counter is reset to zero and then started from that time. This only applies to the log duration and not to the entire rebuild index operation. For example, if you specified a max duration of 60 minutes, that doesn't mean your indexing operation will terminate completely at the end of 60 minutes unless you specified abort after max duration itself. And this applies only for schema modification lock in case of read-only workloads, because the shared locks will not have any conflict with any other shared queries running on the system at the same time. Finally, the main benefits with these new switches is it takes the guesswork out of DBAs, and SQL Server will automatically manage based on the parameters that you specify. It'll place your locks in the low priority queue, so any concurrent resources will continue to run without any issues. And the decision to wait or kill self-blockers once made by the DBA will automatically be issued by SQL Server when the time comes. And if there is no blockers during the duration, it'll be executed immediately. So you can immediately see the benefits of running this, especially in a 24/7 mission critical environment where it is very hard to get a downtime or predict a time where you'll be able to successfully run the query. Now, here's an animation which shows the same behavior for all the four or five sessions that we saw before, how it'll be now with the new behavior. So let's say in this case, session 51 executes a select query, and it requires a shared lock. Nobody else is holding onto a conflicting lock, so it is granted. And now 52 comes, which is your alter table reindex or partition switch. This requires a schema modification lock. Since it's conflicting with your shared lock, it's put in a low priority queue, not the regular queue. And then now 53 will come. The key difference here is in the previous animation you saw 53 was behind 52, but in this case, since 53 doesn't conflict with 51, it's allowed to run along with 51. And same thing with even though 52 finished, now 53 is still running, so 52 has to wait. And if 54 comes along during this time, it will not be blocked by 52 because it's not conflicting with 53. And once 53 and 54 finish, 52 can run. And as soon as 52 finishes, 55 is able to run. And the big difference that you see here is all your concurrent workloads which do not have any lock conflicts can run in parallel. So it immediately increases throughput. And your DDL will wait in your low priority queue and until such time that it's available, a lock is available, or if the max duration has expired, the action will be taken on what you specified as the DBA. So you can immediately see some enhancements, and it takes the guesswork out of DBAs on issuing the statements. So the things to remember when you can issue this statement is covered by this slide. We'll be talking about some of the permissions and security required to run these statements. So in the current behavior, both alter table and alter index requires alter permission on the table. It applies to both source and target tables, like I mentioned, in case of partition switch, because you'll have to take locks on your source partition and your destination partition. And the data security is inherited based on your target table to which you're switching the data into. In case of alter rebuild index, the alter permission is required on both source, basically the table or view which you're rebuilding. Additional permissions which are required are mainly for abort after wait equals blockers. Since this requires you to go and kill any blocking sessions, this requires higher level privilege for the user executing this. So this is same as getting the alter any connection privilege. So for example, if you issue the T-SQL kill command in SQL Server, which also requires alter any connection privilege or higher, the same privilege is required for alter table or alter index if you specify abort after wait equals blockers. In terms of diagnostics, we have added some logging and extranet events and other messages which will help you troubleshooting issues when you're using this feature. So in the error log space, we will log any and every activity of every session that was killed, if you specified abort after variables blockers, if the, your DDL was involved in the deadlock, all that information is included in the deadlock diagnostics in the error log. In terms of DMVs or dynamic management views, you will see now some additional information for both DM trend logs as well as DM OS wait stats. You will see that when the DDL is waiting in the lower priority queue, it'll show low priority wait or convert. And also in the wait stats, you'll see the same information. And finally, if you're waiting, if you issued abort blockers, the DDL will still have to wait till your blocking transactions roll back. During that time, you'll see the wait status as abort blockers. And you also have three new extranet events, which will tell you whenever the state changes from one queue to another. It'll also there's also an extranet event, process killed by abort blockers, which fires when a blocking session is terminated. And finally, whenever you issue a DDL with low priority, we will fire the extranet event DDL with wait at low priority.
This is exciting feature.
Yep.
I'm sure you want to show us how it runs,
yep.
Right?
It's a good time to go and look at how this feature works. We talked about a lot of concepts, and let's go and see how it works in real life. So let me switch to my demo machine. So for this demo, I'm going to use SQL Server 2014 CTP2, which is freely available for all users to download. I have a free copy of the AdventureWorks database installed here, and I have partitioned it for the transaction history table, and we are going to use this for most of our demos today. So you can see that in this table, I have about 12 partitions, and I have about 3 indexes. So let me go ahead and start a blocking transaction in one of the partitions. So this would have this will be today holding a shared log on the transaction history table. So in my another window, I'm going to go and try and switch data from a staging partition into my first partition. So let me go ahead and make sure the partition is free to be switched. So you can see in my T-SQL here that I'm going to be switching from partition 1 of my transaction history table to the partition 1 of staging table. So in SQL Server 2012, this requires a schema modification lock, as I mentioned, and this should get blocked by your other transaction which is running here and holding on to the shared log. Note that I started the transaction here, but I haven't committed a rollback, so all the locks are still being held. So let me go ahead and execute this alter statement. And you can see that though the statement should run immediately, it is blocked forever. So if you go and look at the blocking query output, for example, if I go and run these queries here, which looks at the DM exec sessions, and as well as your DM exec trend logs. And let me zoom in here. You can see that alter table is waiting on a schema modification log, and it's blocked by session 52, which was my select query. So, and you can again see here that it's waiting on the schema modification log. This will wait forever till the other transaction finishes because these are incompatible logs. So this is your today's 2012 behavior. So for the purpose of demo, I'm going to stop this, and let's see how we have enhanced this with 2012. So before I run the 2014 version, let me go ahead and start an extended event session. So I'm going to create a new session. Let's look at what events we are going to collect. So we're going to collect all the three new events I mentioned, the SQL Server log request priority state, which tells if it's low priority or not. And if I'm killing any block sessions, the second event will fire, and the final one will fire if I issue a DDL. I'm sending all the event data to an extranet event file on disk so we can look at it later. So let me go ahead and create and start this session. Now, as I mentioned, you can specify different options when you issue the DDL. So before I do that, I'll show you the new switches. So what we have, the first part of the query is the same as before, but what is new is the with syntax. So here you can specify that you want to issue the DDL at low priority, and then specify the max duration parameter, which is specified as an integer in minutes. So for the purpose of demo, I'm going to use the shortest available integer, which is 1. So this DDL will wait up to 1 minute. And finally, I've specified that this DDL will terminate itself if it does not get the lock in 1 minute. So let me go ahead and run this DDL now. Note that the other transaction is still running. I haven't closed this first transaction. So the behavior is this transaction will wait up to 1 minute, and if it doesn't get a lock in 1 minute, it'll terminate itself. Let's go and see what the diagnostics show us. I'm going to run the same queries as before. Look at the DM trend locks and the DM exec requests. And the key difference to note here is now it's the same schema modification log, but it's waiting at low priority, which you can see from DM trend logs and also from the DM exec sessions. So it'll continue to wait in the low priority queue, which means any other selects which run now will be able to get its lock. It won't get blocked behind this session because it'll be compatible with the first session. Now, up to 1 minute, it'll wait, and if during that interval, if it gets the lock, it'll run. If not, it'll terminate itself, since that's what I have specified in my switch. If you look at the clock at the bottom, it's almost done, and you can see here at 1 minute, it didn't get the lock, so it timed out itself. So this is the message you'll get as the user. Now let's look at a different way of running this. So let's say that you don't want to terminate yourself, but you're okay to terminate the other users, in which case you will specify abort after wait equals blockers, which is the other option that you have. And if we run this now again, up to 1 minute, it'll wait in the low priority queue. And while it's waiting, you will still see the same thing, that it's waiting in the low priority queue here. And the transaction locks show that it's waiting for a low priority schema modification lock, and it's being blocked by your 52 session, which is still running. The main difference between the first option and the second option is, the first option we are terminating the DDL. In the second option, we are terminating any blocking sessions. So in this case, the blocking session is our select query, or the insert query here, which will get terminated. So we are about 20 seconds away from that to happen. So once that happens, you'll also see this extranet event that you killed the blocker was fired, and we'll look at that shortly, and we'll also look at some additional messages that were introduced in the error log. So we are almost coming up to 1 minute now in another 3 seconds, and we'll be able to see that. So now you can see in this case that the query didn't time out, but it completed successfully. And let me go ahead and stop my extranet event session. And let's go look at the data. So you can see that we fired all the corresponding events. The DDL wait at priority shows that we executed an alter table switch. The low priority request state is fired every time we transition the lock state. And then whenever we kill a blocking session, we fire the abort after blockers switch. And each of these events have a corresponding data. For example, the process killed by abort blocker shows which session was killed and who was the session who killed it, and what object in which database locks was. So very useful in troubleshooting if somebody come and complain to you that some session was terminated. Now, one more diagnostic that I want to show you is in the error log, we added some additional information, especially when we kill any sessions. We have added some new diagnostics. So you can see that every time we issue a low priority lock, we log that information, that a DDL was executed with abort after wait equals blockers on which database and table. And we also log every time you kill a blocking session that it was killed by the DDL. So you can distinguish this from a regular kill, because you also will see statements in the error log whenever a regular kill happens. So this statement is slightly different, which will help you differentiate between a regular kill versus an abort kill. So that's all I have for demo for this feature. So let me go back to my presentation.
This is awesome. It will help a lot of the mission critical applications that most of our customers running,
yep,
be able to have very granular control,
yes,
on how the database is,
yes,
run.
I mean, the best part about this is it takes away the guesswork out of administrators. Mm-hmm. You just issue the DDL and forget about it, and SQL Server will automatically manage and find an opportunity in the window, mm-hmm, and execute the DDL as appropriate.
Right. Okay. All right. Let's switch topic. You mentioned earlier in the beginning that there is another feature called single partition online index rebuild.
Yes.
Tell us what it is, why you want to do this, and the details.
Yeah, this is another cool and new improvement. A lot of customer feedback and went into this. So as most of you remember, in SQL Server 2008 R2, we increased support for up to 1,000 partitions. And in SQL Server 2012, we increased up to 15,000 partitions. So one of the common challenges was, how do you maintain a database with thousands of partitions? And as you can see, indexing databases, re-indexing is a very common administrative task to help with query performance. So for, say, let's say database has 15,000 partitions, if you had to rebuild index, you, for a partition table, you could only do it offline for the by partition basis, which means that partition is not available for any user queries. Or if you had to do online, you had to do it for the entire table, which means it's a very heavy resource intensive improvement. So we made some changes in SQL Server 2014 to make it easier for administrators to manage tables which are heavily partitioned. So again, like the previous feature, we are going to talk about what the current problem space is, what are the changes that are providing new enhancements, and some diagnostics. So the problem statement, like I briefly touched upon, is you have two options to rebuild indexes today. Either rebuild online, which requires you to rebuild the entire table online. If it is a partition table, that means you're taking the resource hit for the entire table. Or if you don't want to rebuild the entire table online and you want to build only your selective partition, you'll have to take it offline, which means it's not available for users because it requires schema modification log for the entire duration and it can block all your users. The effect of either of these options is listed on the right side here, is because of the resource and locks it uses, it can lead to timeouts and workload slowdown. And if you're rebuilding the entire table, that means you need to read the entire table into memory. So it's a heavy disk and memory oriented process, as well as it drives your CPU because it's kept busy. At the same time, indexing is a logged operation, so you can see your transaction log grow during this time. And the net effect is it has a significant impact on mission critical workloads. So we want to address some of these challenges in SQL Server 2014. To overcome these challenges, we introduced what is called Single Partition Online Index Rebuild, or SPOIR for short. Let me cover some of the benefits. The first thing is granularity. So as the name implies, we now provide an option for administrators to rebuild only one or more partitions online at a time. So this means you have more availability of the table. So all your other partitions are available except the active partition that's being rebuilt. And even the active partition that's being rebuilt, only the time when we acquire schema modification lock is when it is offline, which is a very short time. But other than that, it should be available for the duration of the rebuild also. Lock priority. So in the first half of this presentation, we looked at the managed lock priority, where we can acquire locks at a lower priority for DDL. So index rebuilds can also take advantage of low priority locks. So you can use this in combination with lock priority. And finally, availability. Since you're only rebuilding a specific partition, it increases the availability of your underlying table, which in effect increases the availability of applications that are using these tables. Therefore, it has a significant improvement for mission-critical workloads. Finally, resource savings. Because since you're building only a single partition, you don't have to consume CPU, disk, or memory resources. And also, your transaction log is kept to a minimal usage because you don't have to bloat the entire log to log every index activity. So diagnostics, just like in the previous case, we have support for online indexing at a partition level, so we no longer raise the 155 error, which you would get in the past if you try to rebuild the partition online. And in the query plan, you can actually now see which partition is being rebuilt. So if you look at the query plan for the DDL, you will see a constant scan operator, and within parentheses, it will show which parameter is being partition is being rebuilt. So the number here indicates partition 4 is being rebuilt, for example. Finally, we have made enhancements to the extended event progress report online index operation, which has some additional data which tells you which partition is being rebuilt and the begin and end of the rebuild. So you can monitor the progress of your index rebuild. Manageability, so we have made some enhancements to the surface area for using this feature. The first thing is, if you are wanting to do this through a programmatic model, which is a SMO interface, the SQL Server Management Objects, you can use that. We have APIs to issue your DDL using SMO. And if you're a PowerShell fanatic, you can also use PowerShell to do this. And finally, in Management Studio, you can use Management Studio to script it. However, to do the actual execution of this DDL, you'll have to do it after you script execute the T-SQL to run this.
Okay, yep. Awesome. This is awesome feature for data warehouse, right?
Yep.
Right. A lot of customers are building data warehouse using multiple partitions.
This will really help. A lot of big customers have already previewed this and given very positive feedback, and we're very excited about adoption of this feature.
Okay. So, great. Show us how it runs.
Yep. Let's go and take a look at how this works, and hopefully you will be able to appreciate the enhancements. Let me switch back to my demo machine. I'm going to go back and use my same database as in the past. And note that I still have my blocking transaction running because I want to show you how this is going to also work with managed lock priority. So let me go ahead and close this one and start another blocking transaction. Okay, so before I do that, let me show you all the partitions in my database. So again, as I mentioned, I have 12 partitions and 3 indexes. So one of the common scenarios why you would require rebuild is when your database or partition is fragmented and you want to improve the performance. So reindexing will rebuild your index tree and make it more efficient. So let me go ahead and start a blocking transaction. So before we rebuild, let's go and look at the fragmentation. So I'm going to focus just on index 1. And you can see that some of the partitions are very heavily fragmented, like 60% almost here, 44% here. So let's go and see if we can rebuild just the single partitions. So in SQL Server 2012, the way you would rebuild partition is by issuing a statement like this. And note that in this example, I have rebuilt partition 1, but I have not specified online because you cannot do online and partition rebuild at the same time. You can only rebuild it offline. So in this case, it will take it offline and rebuild it. So if I go ahead and execute this, since I have a blocking lock on the other side, as you can see from the blocking transaction query, even the alter index requires schema modification lock, so it is blocked by the blocking query I had started. So this will wait forever in SQL Server 2012. So let me go back to my main thing. So in SQL, let me go ahead and stop this because I'm going to show you some enhancements. So before I do that, I'll go ahead and start my extended events session Again, I'm going to use the same sessions, event sessions as before. I've also added one more event, which is the online index operation, which will give me the progress of the partition being rebuilt. So let's go ahead and drop and create this session. Let me go ahead and start this. So as I mentioned, partition 3 was very heavily fragmented. So we are going to try and rebuild this. You can see the fragmentation on partition 3 before I do that. That you can see it's almost 60% fragmented. And now let's use the new feature where you can do rebuild online, and at the same time you can specify the partition number. Let me go ahead and execute this. Let me go and stop my blocking transaction since I'm not using manage lock priority, otherwise it'll block forever. So you can see that the partition got rebuilt online, and we can go back and examine if it was really the case. And you can now see the partition is almost 0% fragmented. It's just a small decimal. Now, if you did have a blocking transaction and you had to issue an online partition index rebuild, but you had to wait forever, you can, in fact, use it in combination with managed lock priority, which is what I'm going to show next. So for that, we'll use partition 6. You can see that it's almost 45% fragmented. So let's start a blocking transaction for that. Now for this, I'm going to go ahead and issue a rebuild. But at the same time, I'm going to specify abort after wait equals blockers after 1 minute. And you can see that these are the same switches we used for managed lock priority, and it can also be for partition switching. We can also use it for rebuilding index partitions. So let me go ahead and execute this. So this will wait for up to 1 minute. So if we go back to our diagnostics and look at the blocking sessions, you can see that the alter index is now waiting for a low priority lock, and it's blocked by session 56. And we will wait for this till up to 1 minute, or if we get the lock earlier, we'll execute this. And at the same time, you will also see that this query will, it's about 30 seconds now, another 30 seconds, we'll see that it'll finish. And if this, if the other transaction finished earlier, we'll go ahead and execute this, and your partition will be rebuilt immediately. And we'll also log the same information about if we killed any of the blocking sessions. We will log that in the error log. And we will also take a look at the event, extended events that get fired. So we have almost 7 or 8 seconds left, so we should be done pretty quickly. So if we had specified abort after wait equals self instead, this DDL would have terminated after 1 minute if it could not get the lock. So in this case, since I specified to kill the blockers, it should be able to get the lock. And you can see that the wall clock here is 1 minute, and this command completed successfully. So let's make sure that's happened, and the partition 6, if you remember, had 44% fragmentation. Let's see if that's gone now. So you can see that now it's less than 1%. So it did get rebuilt. Now let's go and stop my extended event session and look at the diagnostics. So in the error log, again, we add some new information every time we kill a blocking session. And you can see that the alter index was issued, and it was issued for table production history. And you can also see that it was issued with these switches on the table and object ID. And when the blocking session is killed, you log this for every blocking session that is killed. And you can see the difference in time that the DDL was issued at 3:32:25, and after 1 minute, it was killed. So it honored the time that we specified. So, and as far as extended event sessions, let's take a look. So you can again see that it'll show the partition that's being rebuilt, which is 6 over here, and then beginning and ending of every stage. And you also see the transition of the lock whenever we started waiting in the low priority, and then when we finished waiting, and then when we aborted the blockers, and also finally when we, for each session we killed, we log the session diagnostics also. So a lot of useful stuff when you rebuild indexes we can use to troubleshoot the problem.
Awesome. These are two great features. I really love these features to make all the databases more highly available.
Yep.
You mentioned earlier that you spoke, you work with multiple customers that's trying, tested this already and give good feedback.
Yep.
Can you share some best practices that you get from them as well?
Yes, definitely. We looked at a lot of customer scenarios and we came up with some of the guidances for how to use these features. So let's take a look at some of these. Abort after wait equals blockers is very useful only if you're having long transactions. If you have a workload where your transactions run within a second or two, then you don't have to specify abort after wait equals blockers, because the chances of SQL Server finding a window to give you the log is very high, so you'll be able to get the log easier. The second recommendation is locking. You need to be aware of your workload settings so you can define your max duration accordingly. And keep in mind that when you use these switches for partition switching, the partition switch requires lock at both the source and target tables. So it is very possible that it acquired lock on the one side immediately, but it's waiting on the other side because of the workload. So if it's a dormant table, then the chances of getting the lock is much higher. The third recommendation is avoid putting these GDLs in nested transactions, because if you start a transaction, do some work queries, and then if you issue the DDL in the same transaction, then your source transaction is running longer and max duration can affect the length of the transaction. So issue this DDL in their own transactions. And the final recommendation is be aware of transaction log growth. This can be impacted by max duration. If you specify a very long max duration, you can go up to 50 days. You'll be waiting for almost a long time and holding the log records, which can prevent log truncation. So it can require result in performance issues. So these are the recommendations to keep in mind when you're using these features.
Okay, awesome. Yep.
So that's all I have for you today on this online database operations.
Thank you so much, AJ. Everyone, thank you so much for watching this session on online database operations. Hopefully this will give you a good sense of how the log priority works, as well as the how single partition online index rebuild works as well.
Yep.
Right. We're happy that you'll be able to tune in. We'll take another 15-minute break before we come to another session. Thank you so much for allowing us to give you this opportunity to see SQL Server 2014 high performance capabilities. Thank you so much.